Good morning to all science enthusiasts. I, Shivaji Deshmukh, a student from Bajaj Science Center, Vardha, holds this privilege to host today's program. On the very first note, I would like to express my sincere gratitude and genuine warm welcome to respected Sujata Bhargava ma'am. We are extremely thankful to Bajaj Science Center, Vardha, for this wonderful initiative to organize weekend stories, which are held every Sunday, and this is our 9th weekend story in succession. To Fun with Mathematics by Tushar Tamhane sir. What is enough life is a mind-boggling question. This is introduced to every child by the very famous phrase, who came first, egg or hen? This subject has amazed every curious mind. To explore this topic more, I would like to introduce today's guest speaker, Sujata Bhargava ma'am. A botanist, Sujata Bhargava ma'am has retired as head professor from the botany department of Savitribai Phule University. During her early career, she was in Germany for her postdoctoral work from 1988 to 89. Later, Madam has also visited Germany twice in 1994 and 2002, where she worked on crop photosynthesis and molecular plant pathology area. She has completed more than 10 different research projects, which were funded by government, DBT, DST, DAE, CSIR, and UGC. She has supervised 13 PhD students and 3 for MPhil degrees. She has published more than 40 research papers which were published in international journals. Professor Bhargav was principal investigator for developing postgraduate e-course in botany during the MHRD UGC program, popularly known as EPG Pathshala, supported by Government of India for various theory papers in botany. From 2013 to 2016. She was member of CSIR Examination Committee, NET Examination, commonly known as CSIR NET Exam, and State Eligibility Test, SET Committee, for Life Sciences Examination, also known as CET Exam during 1997 to 2010. After her superannuation, we are fortunate enough to have her in Vardha with us as a mentor at Bajaj Science Center, Vardha. Welcoming our today's guest, Professor Sujata Bhargava ma'am, with much gratitude, I would request madam to please start this today's program.
Thank you, Shivaji. So before I begin, I want to ask you whether you have understood what this topic is about. So let me first tell you that what type of food do we eat? What do we depend on for food? We depend on the plants, isn't it? So today we will see how plants are preparing the food which we ultimately eat. So let us begin the talk then. So the title of the talk is autotrophy. Now, initially, the world, when the earth started, an enormous world, and it did not support any life. However, after some time, the autotroph enabled the beginning of the organic world when they came into existence. So this talk will be about the autotroph, which made it possible for the plants, animals, and all living organisms as we know today to exist. Now, before we do so, let me tell you that carbon is a component of each and every organic compound. Now, carbon can form both inorganic compounds like carbon dioxide or bicarbonate or carbonate, but more importantly, it is unique because it can form covalent bonds with itself or with hydrogen. And these types of bonds enable large compounds of carbon to be created, which are called as macromolecules. The most important bonds in all organic molecules are the C bonds, which enable catenation of the molecule and enable large number of one to the other. Or you have the CH bonds. Now, besides carbon, and carbon, organic compounds may also incorporate elements in them, like nitrogen, phosphorus, sulfur. Today we know organic compounds, and carbon dioxide is the source for most organic compounds. So let us see now how living organisms get carbon. They get carbon in two ways. The autotrophs, which are also called as producers, can convert CO2 or carbon dioxide to organic compounds. And heterotrophs, which are called as consumers, they depend on the autotrophs directly or indirectly for their carbon source. Now, all plants, algae, and some of the photosynthetic bacteria belong to the autotroph, and it is these organisms mainly concentrate on in today's lecture. How do heterotrophs and autotrophs convert this organic carbon for living? They do so by a process called as metabolism. So they acquire organic carbon, then they synthesize compounds from this organic carbon, like carbohydrates, proteins, nucleic acids, lipids, and also they break down these complex compounds to release energy. Now, this building up and breakdown of organic compounds is called as metabolism. And metabolism is very, very crucial to maintain the living state of all organisms. So, in this talk, we will be considering the different two types of autotrophs, namely the chemoautotrophs and the photoautotrophs. We will see carbon dioxide fixation, the energy required by organisms. We see two autotrophs, which have acquired the capacity to capture light energy for fixation of carbon dioxide. Then we move on to see how carbon dioxide is actually fixed, and then move on to study how this fixed carbon is used for metabolic processes. So let us start the talk then with autotrophy. Now, autotrophy is the capacity of an organism to carbon from carbon dioxide, as I have said so in the earlier slide. All autotrophs require a source of energy, a source of electron donors, and of course, source of carbon, this in autotrophs always carbon dioxide. Now there are two types of autotrophs, namely the chemoautotroph and the photoautotroph. The chemoautotroph, they use inorganic chemical reactions as a source of energy, and they also use hydrogen or reduced inorganic compounds as a source of electrons, because you know that carbon dioxide has to be reduced to form organic carbon compounds. On the other hand, photoautotrophs, they use light as a source of energy. All photoautotrophs use light as a source of energy. But the source of electron donors vary. In some photoautotrophs, they carry out anorganic photosynthesis. They use reduced inorganic compounds as source of electrons. Whereas oxygenic photoautotrophs, which carry out oxygenic photosynthesis, they use water as a source of electrons. Now, today we know that carbon dioxide fixation is carried out by protein catalysts, which are enzymes. But proteins are organic compounds. So, how carbon dioxide fixation has taken place before proteins evolved? It is thought that some minerals which contain iron and sulfur could have catalyzed carbon dioxide fixation before proteins existed. So that means even before organic compounds were formed, it was possible for organisms to fix carbon.
So as I told you, there are two types of autotrophs, the chemoautotrophs and the photoautotrophs, and we'll be studying each of them in the next few slides. So chemoautotrophs carry out carbon dioxide fixation in the deep oceans where no light energy or oxygen is available. They do so by getting energy through chemical reactions. What type of reactions? They can use reduction reactions or oxidation reactions. Both are chemical reactions which involve either hydrogen as a which is used for reducing carbon dioxide, or hydrogen which is used for reducing sulfur. Organisms which reduce carbon dioxide using hydrogen are called as methanogens because they synthesize methane. And these organisms belong to the kingdom Archaea. Organisms which reduce sulfur are present from both bacterial as well as the Archaea kingdoms. Now, in addition, oxidation reactions may also occur in some organisms. For example, hydrogen sulfide can be oxidized to sulfur using the oxidized form of iron, that is the ferric form. So ferric becomes reduced to ferrous, and hydrogen sulfide becomes oxidized to form ferrous sulfide. The energy which is released in these reduction or oxidation reactions is used for carbon dioxide fixation. Now, it is thought that such anaerobic redox reactions, which took place when no light energy or oxygen was available to the organisms, represent the most primitive type of autotrophy. The next type of autotrophy is photoautotrophy. Now, this is thought to have originated in shallow lakes because in these photoautotrophs, light energy is used to fix carbon dioxide, and this process is called as photosynthesis. So light could penetrate shallow lakes, and so this process is thought to have taken place in these lakes. There are two types of photosynthesis which can occur. One is where light energy is used to oxidize inorganic compounds, and the energy released is used to fix carbon dioxide. So this equation shows the conversion of hydrogen sulfide to sulfur brought about by light energy. Now, the chemoautotrophs, which I told you earlier, were also able to oxidize hydrogen sulfide to sulfur, but instead of light energy, it used the chemical reaction with ferric for oxidizing hydrogen sulfide to sulfur. These chemoautotrophs and the organisms which carry out anoxygenic photosynthesis, which is the anoxygenic photoautotrophs, they are thought to have arisen about 3.5 billion years ago, before oxygen was found in the Earth's atmosphere. Now, what is the evidence for this? They have identified recently some fossils in which they could identify microbes which were methanogens, or these chemoautotrophs, or anoxygenic photoautotrophs, and the date of that rock was 3.5 billion years ago. So this was evidence that life as carried out by these autotrophs would have existed about 3.5 billion years ago. Even today, these chemoautotrophs and anoxygenic photoautotrophs, they enable life to take place in either places where no light or oxygen is available, or where light is available but no oxygen is available. The chemoautotrophs also play an important role in biogeochemical cycling of elements. However, the most prevalent form of photosynthesis or photoautotrophy seen on all land organisms is oxygenic photosynthesis. Over here, as I said before, water is used as a source of electrons, and light energy oxidizes this water and liberates oxygen. So for the first time, oxygen accumulation started through this reaction, and oxygen accumulated in the Earth's environment. So therefore, these organisms which carried out oxygenic photosynthesis enabled present-day life on Earth, which is mostly aerobic. Now, the process of oxygenic photosynthesis is thought to have started about 2.5 billion years ago, and organisms which could carry out oxygenic photosynthesis were the cyanobacteria. The fossil evidence for this is also available, where it is seen that stromatolites are fossils which are formed by cyanobacterial mats which are trapped in between rock-like layer of elements. These cyanobacterial mats, the rocks containing these cyanobacterial mats are called as stromatolites, and the fossils date back to 2.5 billion years ago. So we have seen in the previous slides that both chemoautotrophs and the photoautotrophs are able to harvest either light energy or energy from chemical reactions for fixing carbon dioxide. But how do they do that? That is what we need to see now. The first step in harvesting of the energy is by formation of a proton gradient across the cell membrane. And this proton gradient arises mainly due to redox reactions. The potential energy of the proton gradient is used for synthesis of ATP, which we shall see in the next slide. So let us see how the proton gradient forms across the membrane. We'll take an example of the chemoautotroph, which we discussed earlier, where hydrogen sulfide is oxidized to form ferrous sulfide and protons are liberated. So a reduced compound, hydrogen sulfide, is oxidized to form a sulfur compound, a sulfide. In this process, protons are liberated and they accumulate outside the cell. So therefore, outside the cell, you have an accumulation of protons. Now the electrons from this reaction, from this redox reactions, are used to reduce a iron compound which is present in the membrane, which is in the ferric form. So this iron compound is reduced to the ferrous form, and this ferric compound now forms a ferrous compound. Now this reduced compound is made use of by some reactions which are going on in the cytoplasmic side. Okay, so in the cytoplasmic side, the ferrous form of iron transfers the electrons to a terminal acceptor of electrons, which is oxygen, as is shown in the equation above. So ferrous plus oxygen plus the protons from the cytoplasm are used to form ferric again, and water is formed. So you see, on the inner side of the membrane, protons are used up, and on the outer side of the membrane, protons are liberated. So this forms the proton gradient. More protons outside, less protons inside. Now the earlier redox carriers were thought to be pyrites, which lined the deep ocean vents. Then protein-based redox carriers carry out these functions today, and such proteins which have iron present in either the ferric or ferrous forms are known to occur in organisms today. So we have seen how the proton gradient is created. Now we have to see how the proton gradient is made use of for synthesizing ATP. Now ATP synthase is a wonderful molecule because it works like a machine. A machine because it is converting energy from in one form to mechanical energy. So it is converting the potential energy of the proton gradient to mechanical energy. The equation that is written over here shows that ADP combines with inorganic phosphate and forms ATP and water. But now look at the protons. When ATP forms, the protons outside and inside are same in number. Okay, so initially there would be more protons outside, and when the protons outside move inside the cell, or when the protons outside are neutralized by the proton gradient being neutralized, then ATP synthesis takes place. So let us see further about how this takes place. The ATP synthase consists of two subunits, the F0 subunit and the F1 subunit. When the proton gradient is neutralized, this takes place by the F0 subunit. Now this F0 subunit, it neutralizes the proton gradient, and the energy is transferred to rotate this ATP synthase molecule. Now, due to rotation, the F1 subunit, which has several sites, some sites where ADP and PIF and inorganic phosphate can bind, then further rotation allows another site where ADP and phosphorus combine to form ATP, and further rotation liberates the ATP from the active site. So continuous rotation of the ATP synthase, which takes place due to neutralization of the proton gradient, enables ATP synthesis to occur. Now, ATP is also synthesized by a similar ATP synthase in mitochondria. And this happens during the process of respiration. During respiration, energy is released by conversion of sugar to carbon dioxide. Okay, and again, this energy released forms a proton gradient first, and then this proton gradient is used by the ATP synthase to synthesize ATP. Now, the ATP works as an energy currency of the cell. Why energy currency? Because we use money, right? Money is our currency. By exchanging money, we are able to buy different types of things. Similarly, by exchanging ATP, you can carry out several types of reactions. So therefore, it is called as an energy currency of the cell. Now, in the earlier slide, I told you about oxygenic photosynthesis, which occurs which is most prevalent on Earth today. But remember that even though it is prevalent, the chemoautotrophs are supporting life even in environments where no light penetrates or no oxygen is available. So they are also equally important. Okay? So we'll study something about photosynthesis now. We have seen that photoautotrophic organisms use light energy for fixation of carbon dioxide, and the process is called as photosynthesis. This oxygenic photosynthesis is carried out by cyanobacteria, algae, and the entire plant kingdom, and is an important source of accumulation of oxygen in the air, which all heterotrophs use for respiration. So we'll see how this process of photosynthesis was discovered in the first place. So a scientist called Priestley, as early as 1774, he carried out an experiment wherein he used a bell jar in which he placed a mouse and a lit candle. After some days, he observed that the candle was extinguished and the mouse was also dead. He said that somehow the mouse and the candle appeared to injure the air which was present inside the bell jar. Now, he placed a plant in the same bell jar, and it was seen that when he placed the plant in the bell jar, the mouse and the candle, they seemed to function for a long time. Okay, therefore, he thought that the plant in some way restored the injured air and made it healthy once again. This was long ago in 1774. Then, a few years later, another scientist called Ingenhaus in 1779, he showed that light is required for carrying out a process by which plants give out air. Okay, so he placed some hydrilla plants, which is an aquatic plant, in a beaker of water, and he covered these plants with a funnel. And on top of that funnel, he inverted a test tube. Now he saw that when this apparatus was placed in light, the plants gave out bubbles of air which accumulated in the test tube. Now, what was the nature of the gas which was liberated? Ingenhaus didn't know it at that time. He just knew that it was able to support combustion. So he just called it as combustible air. At the same time, Lavoisier, a few years ago, had discovered oxygen. And it was later shown that this combustible air, which Ingenhaus called as combustible air, that was indeed oxygen. So it was known that when plants are placed in light, they give out oxygen. Later in 1796, a scientist called Senebier showed that plants not only release oxygen with the help of sunlight, but they also absorb CO2 or carbon dioxide. And further, in 1804, another scientist called Saussure showed that plants use this carbon dioxide and water from the soil, they liberate oxygen and also they gain weight, that is, they synthesize biomass. So we came to understand quite a lot about photosynthesis by the work carried out by these early scientists. Now, where does this photosynthesis process take place? That was not known to these scientists. It was in 1837 that a scientist called Hugo von Mohl, he for the first time saw discrete bodies which were green in a plant cell. These bodies were later called as chloroplasts. Schimper observed in 1883 that these chloroplasts were quite similar to cyanobacteria, which had been discovered by them. Okay. And later, as we all know, it led to the endosymbiosis hypothesis, which said that the eukaryotic cell engulfed these cyanobacteria to form the chloroplast organelle. So what do the chloroplasts look like? They are double membrane structures. They have a matrix called as stroma, and the pigments, the photosynthetic pigments, are present in membranes which form an internal membrane system in this organelle. And these membranes are stacked one on top of the other to form what are called as grana. So the next question we ask is, how is light captured by chloroplasts? So far we saw that plants could use light for liberating oxygen, they could use light for fixing carbon dioxide, and they could gain weight by this process. So we'll see each of these processes step by step. So light is captured by chloroplasts in various ways. Now algae, bacteria, and plants, all of them carry out light capture, and this is carried out by pigments which are called as chlorophylls. Chlorophyll was first isolated in 1817 by two scientists called Taventou and Pelletier. This was in 1817. If you look at a chlorophyll molecule, you will see that it has a ring of four heterocyclic nitrogen compounds, which are binding a magnesium atom in the center. This ring is called as the porphyrin ring. And this type of a ring is also seen in a very unrelated compound called as heme, which is present in hemoglobin. Okay. In hemoglobin, instead of magnesium, there is iron in the center. Okay. Now, the chlorophylls in bacteria are similar in structure to the chlorophylls found in higher plants. They vary slightly in the type of groups which are present on those rings. Now, besides the chlorophylls, there are various other pigments called as accessory pigments, which are called as antennas because they can capture light energy of different wavelengths. Okay, so as seen in the graph, shows a spectrum below the graph, and it is seen that chlorophylls, chlorophyll A and B, they are able to absorb light in the blue region and in the red region of the spectrum. Whereas the accessory pigments like carotenoids or phycoerythrins or phycocyanins, we won't go into the details of these, but these pigments, they are able to also capture light from the green or the yellow region of the spectrum. Bacterial chlorophylls, in fact, they can also capture light, or in fact, they capture light in the further region of the spectrum, that is above 700, 750 or 800 nanometers light can be captured by bacterial chlorophylls. So we have seen now that chlorophylls capture light, and chlorophylls, they mainly use red and blue wavelengths. They can absorb red and blue wavelengths. But we have no proof yet that the red and blue wavelengths which are captured by chlorophylls are indeed used for photosynthesis. A scientist called Engelmann in 1881 carried out a very nice experiment where he generated a light spectrum as seen in the figure here. He used a prism to generate a spectrum of light which he shined onto a slide on which was placed a filamentous algae. Okay, so you can see that there is an algal filament placed on the slide. Along with the algal filament, in the medium in which this algal filament was placed, were also some aerobic bacteria, and they are called as aerotactic bacteria because they tend to accumulate wherever there is oxygen. Indeed, after some time, he could see that the aerobic bacteria were seen to accumulate in large numbers in the blue region and the red region of the spectrum. Okay, so this was proof that the chlorophylls, which were known to absorb red and blue wavelengths, were able to use this light for carrying out photosynthesis because oxygen was liberated to a large extent in these wavelengths. Okay, so these wavelengths were considered to be most effective for photosynthesis. Now, when light energy is captured by chlorophyll, it has to be transferred to a specific chlorophyll molecule, which is situated also in the membrane, which is called as the reaction center chlorophyll. So you have two complexes lying side by side in the thylakoid membrane. One is the photosynthetic reaction center complex, and the other is a light harvesting complex. Now, all these pigments from the light harvesting complex, they capture light energy of different wavelengths and they transfer them to the chlorophyll present in the photosynthetic reaction center. The transfer is carried out by what we call as resonance transfer. But what is special about this chlorophyll present in the photosynthetic reaction center? When this chlorophyll is excited by light, two electrons are ejected from this chlorophyll molecule. Now, what happens to the electrons which are ejected from the chlorophyll was worked out by two scientists called Hill and Bendall in 1960. So you see that the earlier processes were all known quite early in the 1880s. The whole process was understood, and then there was a big gap because the further processes required a lot of more sophisticated techniques to be used to understand them. So Hill and Bendall in 1960 carried out experiments which proved that the excited electrons from chlorophyll were accepted by some chemical compounds called as electron acceptors. These were also present bound to proteins. Now, after the electron acceptors accept the electrons are transported in a stepwise manner from one acceptor, which now acts as a donor, to another acceptor, then that acts as a donor and it transfers the electrons to another acceptor, and so on. So this is a downhill transfer. Downhill, why? Because at each step, some energy is lost. Some energy of the excited electrons is lost. Now, this energy which is lost is used to form a proton gradient, as I have told you earlier, and it is ultimately used to synthesize ATP. Now, the electrons are finally accepted by a compound called as NADP, and that is reduced to form NADPH. We need not consider this further. But what we want to see over here is that from where does the oxygen come? How is the oxygen liberated? Now, you know that the chlorophyll has lost two electrons due to excitation by light. These electrons need to be replaced. The hole in the chlorophyll has to be filled by these electrons. And this is carried out by a process called as photolysis of water. Okay, a set of proteins present adjacent to the photosystem reaction center carries out this process. So water is oxidized to liberate oxygen, and the electrons are transferred to replace the electrons from which were lost by the chlorophyll. So we see that as a result of light energy being absorbed by chlorophyll, ATP, NADPH, and oxygen are formed. Now, what happens to the ATP which is generated, and what is it used for? ATP and the NADPH, what is it used for? We saw that oxygen is liberated, so that is not used further other than for respiration. But this ATP and NADPH are used for fixing CO2, and we shall see how this takes place, which was found first by a scientist called Calvin in 1957, who later received a Nobel Prize for his work. Now, around this time, radioisotope of carbon called as C14 was known. And he used C14O2, that is a carbon dioxide formed using this C14 radioisotope of carbon. Now, why did he do that? This radioisotope of carbon, if the carbon is transferred from carbon dioxide to any other compound, will light up when it is exposed to an X-ray film. You understand? So this carbon dioxide, which has the C14 present in it, will be able to liberate beta particles. And these particles, beta particles, which are radioactive, which are emitted by this radioactive C14, are able to expose an X-ray film. Okay, so what experiment did Calvin carry out? So as you can see in this figure, he used a big flask in which he placed an algal suspension. You know that algae can carry out photosynthesis, right? So this algal suspension, into this algal suspension, he injected some radioactively labeled carbon dioxide in the form of bicarbonate. Now, immediately after injecting this, he opened the valve which was at the base, and he killed the algal cells by taking them in hot methanol. So you see, at different time points, from 5 seconds onwards, he was able to stop the reaction at different time points by collecting the algal cells and killing them with methanol. Now, what did he do with this? He separated these aliquots of algal suspension which he collected. He separated what was collected by chromatography. Okay, and this is called as two-dimensional chromatography. It is important that to understand that chromatography separates whatever compounds there could be. Now, the interesting thing was that after separating the compounds using chromatography, when he exposed this chromatography paper to X-ray film, he saw that as early as 5 seconds, one spot was seen to be black. And this was a compound called as phosphoglyceric acid. So phosphoglyceric acid was formed from 14CO2 as soon as 5 seconds, as early as 5 seconds. Okay. So that means this was the earliest proof that C14O2 is used to synthesize 3-phosphoglyceric acid, which is likely to be the first organic carbon compound formed during photosynthetic carbon dioxide fixation. After some more time had lapsed, he found that this C14 entered various other compounds like organic acids, amino acids, other sugars, etc. So the carbon dioxide which was formed, which was fixed as phosphoglyceric acid, was subsequently transferred to synthesize various different compounds. So Calvin in this way worked out the entire cycle of carbon dioxide fixation, which we today know as the Calvin cycle. Okay. How does this take place? In this carbon dioxide fixation cycle, carbon dioxide is seen to bind to a 5-carbon sugar called as ribulose bisphosphate. Okay. A key enzyme in this binding of the carbon dioxide to this 5-carbon sugar is an enzyme called as ribulose bisphosphate. phosphate carboxylase, which is a key enzyme in Calvin cycle. Okay. Now, this enzyme catalyzes this binding of carbon dioxide to RuBP or ribulose bisphosphate, and immediately the 6-carbon molecule splits to form two molecules of 3-phosphoglyceric acid, as we have seen earlier. Okay. Now, what happens to this 3-phosphoglyceric acid? Calvin investigated further. He found that this 3-phosphoglyceric acid is then reduced to a glyceraldehyde. You know that an acid, when it is reduced, forms an aldehyde. So it is reduced to glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. And for this reduction step, the light energy products, namely ATP and NADPH, are used. Okay, the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is then used for synthesis of sugars. But now in this process, you see that RuBP will be used up. The ribulose bisphosphate will be used up if all of it is used for formation of sugar. So it needs to be regenerated for this cycle to continue. So some of the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is used to resynthesize or regenerate ribulose bisphosphate so that it is ready to accept the next molecule of carbon dioxide. And ribulose bisphosphate carboxylase will catalyze this reaction of carbon dioxide fixation. So we saw that at the end of carbon dioxide fixation, you get sugars. Now, some of the sugars are used for formation of starch, and plants store the starch in leaves, or the sugars are transported to the rest of the plant, which cannot carry out photosynthesis, like roots or fruits or flowers, etc. So anyway, carbon dioxide is therefore fixed in the form of sugar or starch. It can also be eaten by heterotrophs, where they get the carbohydrates, like we get our source of carbon compounds, organic carbon, by eating plants. So we get sugars, we get starch, we get amino acids, which are also organic compounds. And all these compounds which have been produced by plants are used by autotrophs as well as heterotrophs to carry out metabolism. So there are two types of reactions occurring during metabolism. In one type of reaction, which is called as anabolism, you have synthesis of complex compounds, namely carbohydrates, proteins, lipids, and nucleic acids. Now, these synthesis reactions, which is called as biosynthetic processes, all of them require ATP. Now, where does this ATP come from? In heterotrophic organisms and also in autotrophic organisms, the chunk of ATP comes through the process of respiration. So respiration uses the products of anabolic reactions, that is all the complex organic compounds which are synthesized, and these compounds are broken down into some simpler compounds till ultimately carbon dioxide is released. This process is called as respiration, and ATP is released during respiration. We are not concerned with respiration in this talk. Now, ATP is then used for anabolic processes, but besides anabolism, it can also carry out processes like transport or excretion or movement. As I told you, ATP is an energy currency, so it can be used for diverse processes. So I will summarize over here. We have seen in this talk two lifestyles which are shown by organisms, namely autotrophy and heterotrophy. We have seen three types of autotrophic processes, namely chemoautotrophy, anoxygenic photosynthesis, which is also called as chemosynthesis, and oxygenic photosynthesis. Then we have seen that the energy is harvested in the form of a proton gradient generated across membranes, which provides the energy for synthesis of ATP, which is the energy currency in a cell. Then we moved on to the photoautotrophs, and we have studied how photosynthesis was understood by man. And we saw that there are two types of processes. One type of reactions which use light energy, and the second type of reactions which fix carbon dioxide to form organic carbon. Finally, we saw how the organic carbon is used by autotrophs and heterotrophs for carrying out anabolic and catabolic processes. So you see that autotrophs are at the base of the organic world. They enable all sorts of heterotrophs, whether the heterotrophs are growing in regions which are devoid of oxygen, devoid of light, or in the presence of oxygen and in the presence of light. Autotrophs are required for sustaining life on Earth. Now, before closing, I would like to share with you one of an interesting application of the knowledge we have gained from this particular lecture. Now, several rovers have been sent to Mars, rovers as seen in the photo shown here. Now, these rovers have landed on Mars, and they were sent with the objective of finding signs of life on that planet. Now, the earlier rovers which were sent have already detected the presence of methane, hydrogen sulfide, as well as traces of water on Mars. The rover which was sent this year, called as the Perseverance rover, that is looking for the possibility of autotrophic microorganisms, which could possibly have lived on Mars or maybe living on Mars even today. So in future, you may hear that Mars is inhabited with one of the types of organisms that lived on the early Earth. Okay, so our lecture on autotrophy could help in understanding whether there is a possibility of life existing on Earth. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, I'd be willing to answer them.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for this wonderful session. Session got interrupted because of network issue, but somehow you have ended it on a high note. Let us take few questions from the students now. Students, sure. You can use the chat box for your queries. We'll take your questions one by one. I'm inviting Krishna with his question.
Yes, Krishna.
Ma'am, my question is that when we eat plant or food such as vegetables and all these things, so ma'am, when we eat them, so ma'am, we get energy, no? So yes. Ma'am, the energy we get is from the stored energy in the plants in the form of ATP, or means we take some materials from them and synthesize our own energy.
Yes, this is an important question. Now, all heterotrophic organisms, and we are ourselves heterotrophic, we eat plants as a source of food, right? Now, when we eat plants, the sugar, starch, or other organic carbon molecules which are present in the plants are used for respiration. So all heterotrophic organisms obtain their energy by converting the food through the process of respiration to ATP. We cannot fix carbon dioxide, so we depend on plants. We don't use ready-made ATP from plants. We use the food and we convert it to ATP through the process of respiration. Okay?
Yes, Krishna, is it clear or you want clarification? More?
No, sir.
Do you have more questions?
No, sir. It is clear.
Okay, good. YouTube viewers can use their chat box for their queries, questions. What is the name of the scientist who did bell jar experiment? This is there on the YouTube.
Okay, it was a scientist called as who was known as Joseph Priestley. And he found this in 1777, so long, long ago.
Yes, Krishna, you can ask. One minute. Yes.
Ma'am, why don't we use the directly that ATP or the energy stored in the plants for ourselves? Means, ma'am, why do we convert it in our form? What are the factors?
Okay. Now, Krishna, you see that ATP is used up very quickly for sustaining the processes which are being carried out in the plant itself. So ATP is never accumulated in plants. It is immediately used to respiration. It is used for synthesis, anabolic reactions. It is used for other processes like growth, etc. And all the ATP is turned over all the time. So ATP forms ADP, ADP again forms ATP. In fact, if you consider human beings themselves, we turn over ATP, ADP, ADP to ATP so many times that the number of ATP molecules which are formed in a day is equivalent to our body weight. Do you understand that? This is the amount of ATP which we are generating and using each day. 60 kgs.
Next question is from Anjali. Anjali, you can ask.
Yes. A very good morning, ma'am. Ma'am, my question is that as you have told that we have found many evidences like fossils or like they are 3.5 billion years ago. So ma'am, how can we find or date the age of fossils?
Okay, the technique for doing that is called as radiocarbon dating. And over here, I think I have covered this in one of your talks, but nevertheless, now radioactive carbon is always there in trace amounts on Earth. Okay, so this carbon can give out a signal that in the form of beta particles, and these can be picked up by some active receivers. Okay, now if you start off with say 1 gram of carbon, then after about 5,000 years, it is reduced to 0.5 gram of carbon. Okay, so you say that if I start off with 1 gram of carbon, after 5,000 years, I will be left with 500 milligrams of carbon. Okay, so then in this way, I can now look for the age of the fossil based on how much carbon could be present then in the air and how much carbon is remaining. Because once an organism dies, then it can no longer use this carbon from the air. Okay, whatever carbon 14 it has accumulated remains in it. Okay, so after that, there is no further input of carbon. So you can find out when the organism would have died, because after that, there is no change in the carbon, and that carbon will continue decaying. It is called as decay. Okay, so whereas a living organism, due to respiration or photosynthesis, is constantly exchanging carbon dioxide and oxygen with the air. So the level of 14 carbon, C14, in our bodies is the same as that exists in the air. Okay, so this is how carbon dating is carried out. Maybe I can explain it to you better in a separate meeting. What is? Okay, oxidation is when electrons are by a chemical which gets reduced. So one compound is reduced and the other is oxidized. So oxidation reactions, which I considered as oxidation reactions, was the oxidation of hydrogen sulfide to sulfur. Okay, how did this come about? The hydrogen sulfide lost electrons, which were accepted by an oxidized compound, which is ferric, and ferric was reduced to ferrous. So oxidation can be either loss of electrons or loss of hydrogen. I can't hear you, Govind. Of ATP. I'm not able to hear you.
Yes. What if there is no consumption of ATP?
If there is no consumption of ATP, we die. Okay, we die, the plants will die. ATP is required for maintaining the living state, because as I told you, metabolism is what supports life. And ATP is an important substance which sustains metabolism, which is required for sustaining life. So without ATP, we won't exist. No life could exist. Now earlier on, the ATP is used because the third phosphate, which attaches to ADP, is attached by a high energy bond. It's called as a high energy bond. Now, before ATP was present, the very early organisms used a bond called as the thioester bond, which is also a high energy bond, for their source of energy. Okay, so at that time, sulfur was abundant on Earth, and these organisms used a bond which was formed by S with an organic molecule, which was a high energy thioester bond. Later, ATP took over the function.
Next question from YouTube viewer only. Why does plant take only carbon dioxide and not oxygen?
Okay. Now, I never said in the lecture that plants do not take up oxygen. Plants in the process of photosynthesis take up carbon dioxide and release oxygen. But remember, plants are living organisms, and all living organisms carry out respiration. And during respiration, oxygen is taken in and CO2 is liberated. So oxygen is in fact the terminal acceptor of electrons in the electron transport chain, which takes place during respiration. So all organisms, plants, animals, autotrophic, heterotrophic, all of them carry out respiration. And in that process, oxygen is taken up and carbon dioxide is released. Now, in the absence of light, plants do not carry out photosynthesis. So they do not take up carbon dioxide and release oxygen. So when photosynthesis is not taking place, you will find that there is, you will be able to detect respiration. That is the take up of oxygen and liberation of carbon dioxide. During the day, respiration is masked because whatever CO2 is liberated during respiration is taken up for photosynthesis and oxygen levels will increase. Okay.
Next, I am inviting Prajwal from 9th standard. Yes, Prajwal.
Ma'am, glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is a 3-carbon compound.
Yes.
So, why is it that Calvin cycle has to be repeated 6 times to form 1 glucose molecule? Can't it be repeated only 2 times?
Well, the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, which is a 3-carbon compound, 1 glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate will be used to form the sugar. But 1 glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate is cycled back to form RuBP, that is ribulose bisphosphate, so that another molecule of carbon dioxide can be accepted. So if you see this Calvin cycle in detail, in each time, you know, you are regenerating a 5-carbon sugar, 5-carbon compound, from a 6-carbon compound, which is formed by accepting of carbon dioxide by RuBP. So in each cycle, in one cycle, 1 carbon is converted from CO2 to sugar. In the second cycle, the second one, because remember, in each cycle, 5 carbons are again going in for regeneration of RuBP. Is this okay?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Next question from YouTube viewer. Atharva wants to know whether all heterotrophic plants are eatable.
All?
Heterotrophic plants are eatable.
Heterotrophic plants?
Yes.
So, firstly, what would be heterotrophic plants? Plants which are unable to fix carbon dioxide. So, there are plants like this, you are right. These are parasitic plants like cuscuta, you may have seen. Now, these plants lack chlorophyll. They do not fix carbon dioxide. So they are heterotrophic. So these plants, they have to obtain their organic carbon from another host plant. So they take up sugars directly from the host plant and they carry out respiration like how all other heterotrophic organisms do so. Is it okay?
So with this, we would like to end this session. So before ending, I am thankful to Sujata ma'am who has taken out her time for this lecture and prepared and given a complete view of the origin of these organic world. Thank you very much, ma'am, for your time. Next week, again, with some speaker and with some new topic, we'll meet here on this YouTube platform. Till that, take care. Goodbye.